Hello and welcome to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. My first guests this evening are Steve Barry, also known as the Licorice Dragon, for some unknown reason, and Laser Girl. And it's your second visit to me here, because when I first had you on the show, it was early days for this musical career, and you were still talking about what to do and where to go with this. Yeah. How did you meet Steve in the first place? Did he pick you up in a supermarket?
Give him the real story.
Yeah, short story. He called me out of the blue. I was standing at the bus stop, thinking to give up with the music. I've been trying by myself for 8 years, maybe, or nine. And then he calls me, says he heard my stuff and he wants to meet up and work together.
Amazing.
I heard it in Marbella. So literally, randomly, I just said...
So you were on holiday?
I was on holiday. What's his track? Who's this girl? And tracked her down.
That was your first foray into the music industry, because actually,
it was.
In the background, I mean, your background is finance.
It is, yeah. I'm a city boy by trade, but I also obviously...
You look like a city boy, Steve.
Yeah, I know.
No, it's the look, isn't it?
Dabble in fine restaurants, and I like the arts, and I've always loved music. So it was my first venture into the music industry, and, yeah, thoroughly enjoyed it. Fantastic. Great to be working with
someone
like
her. And it's been going really well, obviously.
Yeah.
So you're ready to launch a new single and a new video, which we'll look at in a little while. But, I mean, how was the video making process for you? Did you enjoy it, or was it a little terrifying?
It
I know
was
whenever
really
you
fun.
Come in here, you sit there and say, I don't like the cameras, I don't want to look.
Yeah, well, everyone feels that way. It's difficult to look back at yourself, but I'm actually happy with the result. And funny thing, it was done by first-year students from Brighton Film School. And not going to lie, I was expecting it's going to be like, okay. But I'm really impressed. They did a really good job.
I think it's wrong to underestimate
you did
the
do
talent
great. Yeah,
here.
Exactly. Yeah. Talk about
amazing, talented people.
Yeah. Faith in the production company. No, it's fine. No, a guy called Paul Oliveras Paris, fantastic director. And, I like to use local people, local talent, and it just seemed really appropriate. And he's done a fantastic job. Yeah.
Well, specifically, you've kept it local because this song is actually based on a story from a Peter James novel.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which
inspired.
Novel is it?
Dead at First Sight. Same
that's
as the
name
song
the
name.
Song.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Peter, has he heard it?
Yeah, he did.
He has heard it. He absolutely loves it. And, it's inspired by the book. And I was talking about the book because I'm the main character and the main villain in the book itself. Talking to Laser Girl about what it was, and it sort of inspired her to write a track. And then we were lucky enough to work with Steve Mack, which was absolutely mind-blowing, to be honest. And recorded the track and then obviously pumped out the video to go with it.
Again, talents working together from Brighton.
Yeah.
Again.
Yeah.
Well, should we have a look and a listen?
Yeah, great.
Let's have
Thank
a look.
You.
Adam, roll that VT for me. pretty dark, isn't it?
It is, isn't it?
But it's great. If I wasn't such a crumbly old queen, I'd have been up and dancing. But you know, it's very difficult when your legs don't work anymore.
Yeah. So we'll do it on Sunday.
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. I'm just wondering, though, you know, it's about Peter James's book. And I know he's chasing now to make the series of these books with TV companies. Have you pushed him to say you want to do the theme music?
Well, it goes without question. I'm seeing him tomorrow, so it's going to be top of my things to talk about.
Absolutely, because he needs to.
Exactly. Yeah.
And he is a very loyal person.
Do you know what? He is absolutely fantastic. Yeah. And what he does for the community as well as everyone else and the charities is fantastic. He should be on the Theresa May's knighthood list. But
I don't think she's got one anymore, Steve.
Well, but she,
I'm not
she
sure
has,
if any of them
she
have
has been announced in some today, but he should be on there. But yeah, really good.
Now, your official launch is on Sunday. And Steve, you work at the top end of our food chain here with fine dining, but you're also involved at the bottom. And I know on a Sunday night I'm coming along because we're getting chips.
Yes.
Ah, I love chips.
Yes.
Who doesn't love free chips?
But also, we're getting this.
Yeah, I'm like yin and yang. So you've got fine dining, but you've got absolutely fabulous people, the beef fries guys.
Laser Girl Chip.
Yeah,
dip. I'm going to open it and stick my finger in it because I want to taste it.
It is absolutely amazing. It is vegan.
I stick my finger in it, no one else can eat it. They kind of.
That's the best way. Now, you tell me that's not one of the best sauces you've ever tried.
That is really good. Oh, it's got quite a kick, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has. It's called It's Hot, obviously. And
this is working in association with beef fries.
Yeah, the beef fries.
Brighton's best chips.
Brighton's best, absolutely. Best fries that there are. Mm. A fantastic team. And
of course, the Dove Lovers Foundation, couldn't it? It's the right kind. I love the video. I love the song. I love those little references. I love the Russian dolls in there.
Yeah.
All those things are lovely, because I know you are Russian. Really wish you the best of luck with
it. Thank you very much.
Already, you know, the word on the industry scene is that this is a great song.
Yeah.
And the feedback for the video has been really strong.
The feedback's been great, and we dropped the EP, as you know, and it's been
Played. It's available for download.
It's played up and down the clubs and radio stations, and the feedback we're having from the professional promoters has been fantastic. So we're really, really pleased. So come and see you again in a few months and see where we are.
Well, we want to have you back when the whole album is finished.
Love to.
Yeah. It'll be wonderful.
And thank you for following us all the way through.
It's been great to see the journey, and it's so exciting. Thank you for coming in again.
Thanks for having us.
Do come back. And good luck, and I'll see you on Sunday for chips.
You're lovely.
Can't wait.
Can't even
know me. A bag of chips on anybody's. Right, we'll be back after these ads for more guests. We'll see you then. Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. My guest now are Mariah Jastrzebska. Close?
Not too bad.
Not too bad. I mean, it has
I do offer lessons.
Too many consonants in it and not enough vowels, as most Polish names have. Brenna O'Connor, lovely to have you here, Brenna.
Thank you.
And Elf Lyons.
Hello.
What a set of names. It's fabulous, isn't it?
Strong names.
Wonderful.
We've all got a strong dress sense.
Elf. And your parents must have been having fun. Or were you not christened Elf?
Elf was a nickname I was given by a yoga instructor that I met underneath an organ when I was 18, which there are lots of stories to that.
We'll get on to that before. I quite like the idea of you underneath an organ, Elf. Yeah. But Mariah, you've come in today to talk about a festival which opens this week in Brighton, The Coast is Queer. And it's a fantastic literary festival focusing on the LGBTQ+ community. I know that you've been very involved in the writing scene down here now for some time. And what are you doing at this one?
Well, I'm beyond excited about this because it's such an amazing... You know, it's the first time this has ever happened. And we've got an impressive and diverse list of people coming. You know, well-known people like Juno Dawson, Patrick Gale, Jonathan Harvey, Ellie Williams, Kuchenga, and so on.
It's an amazing
lineup. So how they've put this all together, I don't know, but I feel very, very personally proud to be part of it. I'm involved in a number of events. I'm involved in the cabaret on Friday night, and that's with Dean Atter, who is well known in Brighton. He did a residency here, I'm sure you've met him.
Yes.
C Sharp, Tim Redfern, Ella Otomero, and it's hosted by Kuchenga. So that is going to be just so exciting, that event. I'm also involved in a reading on the Saturday with Seni Seneviratne, whose book Unknown Soldier has just come out. It's been Poetry Book Society recommended, and I've just read it, and it's stunning. It's about her father, who was a radio operator in North Africa during the Second World War. He was the only black man in the regiment, and it's about her relationship with him and her reimagining what his life was like during the war. So it's absolutely cracking. So I feel very privileged to be reading with her and in conversation with her. And then the other things I'm doing is I'm running a queer cafe, which is an open mic event, so anyone can come and read their work.
When's
and
that?
That's on the Saturday morning. And it follows on from two writing workshops that myself and Robert Hamburger, who's also, you probably know him, an award-winning poet and writer, and we're going to be running two quick-fire writing workshops where people can just come and let rip on paper or on tablet, however they do it. And that will lead into the open mic. So there's two ways into the open mic, through the workshops or just come along and read your stuff.
Amazing.
So that's the sort of grassroots.
One of the things that I think is really impressive about this, I mean, it's an incredible lineup for a start, and it's quite a big festival.
Yes, it is.
But it's all in one place.
Yeah.
Which means that you're not trundling around. I mean, I know I love the festival, and I love the Fringe Festival here, but sometimes, you know, as a reviewer, I'm out and about. I'm travelling 5 miles across the city to see a 40-minute play, and then 5 miles back across the city to see the next stand-up, and it's nuts. This is all at the Spire, which is at the top of Eastern Road, and I have to say, I was there last week for an incredible production of Spring Awakening, which Apollo Theatre have done. Blown everyone away who's seen it. It's incredible. But the space is beautiful.
Yes, it is.
I mean, you've got to get over the fact that it was once a church.
Yes.
And there's a sign above the altar which says, "He is come," which is an interesting prospect.
Could be taken many ways. Yes. And I love that it's all under one roof.
Yes, that's exactly.
Because symbolically, I love that we as the LGBTQ plus community are all under one roof, one umbrella, one sky. I love that.
I love that as well. And it means that you can turn up. I mean, these events are ticketed, so you need to book.
Some and some.
They're all ticketed,
so you need to book
exactly
to avoid disappointment. But some are free, like the Queer Cafe is free.
Yes.
And there are concessions. But people do need to book, otherwise, you know.
I think it's important as well because you can gear how you do things if you know you've got an audience.
Yeah.
I mean, there's nothing more frightening. I mean, you must know this from doing Fringe events, of sitting there thinking, will anybody show up?
Yeah, and you're just there backstage waiting, going, will there be anyone there? And then there are, and you go, oh, phew.
Yeah.
Oh, no, there are loads of people there. Yeah. And then you've got to perform.
I've just been through exactly that in Edinburgh with a play that I wrote, and it was terrifying sitting there because it was on at 12 noon. And you're sitting there at 12 noon thinking, there's no one here.
But that's lovely, though. Like, the fact that it's all in one place means that everybody can turn up. And even if you're not familiar with different poetry, you can just go and discover new things.
Yeah.
And also get to meet other members of the community. Like you said, the fact everyone's in one place, we're an ensemble. That sounds
that's
brilliant.
Right. And there's a book fair, so if you just want to come in, and there's a bar, so if you just want to come in and browse, look at books, have a drink, have a coffee. Yeah.
Yeah. Wicked.
It's extraordinary to think that this is the first queer literary festival
in
the country. And I know Paul Burston, who is a massive force on the LGBTQ literary scene, runs Polari and runs Parali events and weekends, and they are wonderful. But nothing as big as this, is it? Yeah. I mean, this is huge.
Yes.
And some great names. I can't wait to come and listen to Jonathan Harvey, because I've been a fan for a long, long time. I've read all his books and I've even communicated with him over the years through social media, because although I'm old, I still embrace the new.
I
mean, he's just the most charming, unassuming guy, and a brilliant writer.
Mm,
brilliant writer. And I think he also represents something which is important. I think a lot of the time when people talk about LGBTQ issues, they are political or to do with negative things. And Jonathan's actually an entertainer. And his humour is always there at the forefront. And I think that's really important. You know, this is not a political festival, is it?
Well, it is. It is by dint of what it is.
Yeah.
And what all of us have been up against. So in that sense, it is. But I think because we're writers, we're always looking for the humanity, the connections, the relationships, you know, the joys and the sorrows of all people. So I would say it is, but not political in a sort of evangelical bash you over the head way.
That's a relief, isn't it?
But political because if you're a member of our community, you will at some point in your life be up against it. And given what's happening in the world at the moment, and in other countries, I mean, the country I come from, Poland.
Terrifying what's happening in Poland.
You know,
Poland
we are living in the middle of a backlash.
Yeah.
And I think in the middle of a backlash, to have an LGBTQ literature festival, it's the best thing you can be doing to celebrate who we are, what we are, what we're doing.
It's so interesting because just to exist is a political statement, and to not hide, and also to be creative,
yes,
and to be celebratory,
yes,
and not just define yourself by the labels that other people give you. It's when I find people ask me if my work's political, and I say to still be a woman on stage being silly, because I do clowning and slapstick,
yeah,
that's still a political statement, even though, yes, I don't intend it to be, because, yes, you're defying gender norms.
That's right.
Like you said, you can't help but naturally, just because of who you are, be a political statement.
Yes.
I think there'll be a lot of defying of gender norms.
So exciting. What are the dates of it?
It's this coming weekend. So
the 12th to the 15th.
Brilliant.
So it's very exciting, and I can't wait to go along. And I really, there's some people I really want to go and listen to. Not just the people who have the famous names, but there are some incredible talents there, aren't there?
Well, I think what's wonderful is that there are sort of local people who are well known, but there's also new people that I hadn't heard of that I can't wait to hear.
Yeah.
And that's part of the nourishment, isn't it? That's what's refreshing.
Absolutely.
Is that it's opening things out and it's widening everybody's horizons.
And I'll tell you what I really love about it. It actually reflects the fact that there are creative people out there who are a little bit older. We live in a society where there is an obsession, sorry, very much, but there is an obsession with youth. And that, you know, I know in the publishing world at the moment, if you're over a certain age, they don't even look. And it's great that there are these new publishing houses and organisations putting together something like this. So I'm going to be there. Stay with us though, because we're going to be talking after the break with Elf about guinea pigs. Who knows? Guinea pigs, fabulous. We'll see you after these ads. Look out. Look out. We're here for you.
Look out. Look out. We're here for you.
Hello and welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. I've got a fabulously talented sofa today, and my next guest is Elf Lyons.
Hello.
Elf, guinea pigs.
Yes.
Tell me about them.
So the show is called Love Songs to Guinea Pigs, and it's on at the Comedia on the 9th of October. But last year, so I did lots of different, this is my sixth solo show.
Right.
And last year I did three big solo shows, touring them throughout the world. And what happened was, one of them was a one-woman production of Swan Lake in an hour in French. In French, because sometimes you just want to make life a little bit harder. And then I did a musical about the economy, and yes, I did it on rollerblades and hula hooping. And then I did a show about Medusa in the style of a rock concert. And the whole time I was doing these shows, because you just hustle and you're working and touring, because I do lots of clowning and physical theatre work, what happened was my spine, all the discs in my spine, collapsed. Which, when you're a physical performer, is... It's a bit of a kerfuffle. So the show, Love Songs to Guinea Pigs, is effectively about what happened when I was in hospital and that whole process of re-translating your body when you're a physical performer. And the way I dealt with the effect of not being able to move was I rescued two guinea pigs because they were the
How long were you immobile?
Well, so I went into hospital. So the show finished, Medusa finished on the Saturday. On the Sunday night, I woke up. I couldn't move my legs. I'd wet myself, like, all, you know, problems.
Scary.
Things that you can't just take an ibuprofen for. And I was in hospital for a while and then had to 6 months off touring, so which was a massive change. So I rescued these guinea pigs, and it, the show is sort of like a high spectacle comedy stand-up show with music and singing and still clowning.
Yeah.
But it's about, through the guinea pigs, like we've recreated this guinea pig hutch on stage, and I'm dressed in like an Elton John-esque hospital gown.
Love it. Elton John-esque hospital gown.
Yeah.
So did it open up the back?
It is indeed.
Elton would have loved, actually. It would be quite useful for Elton, wouldn't it?
He's a big fan of the show, I imagine. Yeah. I just want to state that Elton John would be a massive fan of the show.
Absolutely.
And yeah, so I started the show in February, you know, after I was recovering, and then I'm touring it around the UK, which is so exciting. Because, yeah, when you're not able to perform, and that's what your job is, you feel so... And, yeah, so about feeling like a
guinea pig. It must be the biggest... fear of any performer. I mean, the fact that you wouldn't be able to go out there and audition and take on roles and
yeah,
do that.
And also, like, being... Because I studied as a clown, so I went to a school called Goliath in France, in the suburbs of Paris, which is where Sacha Baron Cohen went.
I know it well.
And, oh, yeah.
Well, I studied clowning when I was a student.
Oh,
for
wicked.
A little while.
Oh,
so
cool.
I spent a little bit of time... I spent a lot of time in Paris.
Oh, brilliant.
I spent some time at the London Circus School back then.
Okay, cool.
Which existed, I think, for one summer.
Yeah, it's really interesting, the birth of clown in different areas. And
well, it was weird because this is going back to my... I think I was 21, so a few years ago.
A few years ago.
And then I went over to Paris and I had a private tutor there, an amazing Guatemalan clown.
Cool.
And did a little bit of work at Le Coq.
Oh, Le Coq, yeah. So Philippe Goliot, because he taught at Le Coq and then moved and set up his own school. And so I went there and sort of learning how to be in my body and realised the silliness of my body and its shape and the way you can create, like, slapstick. Like, I'm a big fan of Jacques Tati and Marcel Marceau, and I learned a lot of mime when I was there. So when you have this strength in your body in the ways that you can make it fail on stage, and then suddenly my legs, which are a big majority of my body, like probably 80% of it, I suddenly couldn't use them. It was a bit of a problem. But now I'm back. So I'm very excited to be doing it in Brighton, especially in the Comedia, because it's such a lovely space,
studio. It is a wonderful venue, yeah.
Yeah, and it's the team there are lovely. And it's on a Wednesday as well, which is one of my favourite days of the week to perform.
Of course.
Because audiences are more chilled on a Wednesday. Yeah. Monday, also, they're more stressed. But
there's more chance they'd be free.
Yeah.
On a Wednesday.
Yeah, it's a perfect midweek.
Said the man who never has any days off.
I mean, life is busy.
Well, it is, but it's wonderful when it's busy, and I can't imagine not having a life full of stuff that needs to be done. I mean, you must all feel like that. Beric, you must...
Yeah, it gets manic. I don't know where I am half the time. I've been in between New York, London and Brighton for the past 2 months, and I'm just sort of not sure where I am, but I'm happy to be here.
Yeah.
I'm
sort of in the 70s. I've slipped back. No, it's mad having a busy life, but wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah. Now, I want to ask you about a restaurant that I know of, which is the Guinea Pig Restaurant. Have you been?
No, I haven't.
Have you heard about it?
No, I haven't.
I will give
Tell
you details.
Tell me everything.
This is the most extraordinary restaurant. It's up by the Thames somewhere. Mm-hmm. And the people that own it have guinea pigs everywhere.
Is it the pub? It's the pub where you're allowed to hold guinea pigs? Oh, yes. I've not been. But it's just, I'm so passionate about my guinea pigs because I never expected to be a mother. And now I'm the mother of these two. And they were originally called Snuggles and Sweeps. And I was like, I'm not having those names in Brixton.
So what are they called then?
They're called Clara Cupcakes after a really brilliant hula hoopist from Australia who I met at a drag night in Perth. And the other is called Ian McCulloch. After the lead singer Rebecca and the Bunnymen. So I've got these two just gallivanting around my living room in my bedroom, my flat in London. And it's just, it's really nice having animals. And it really teaches you how to love, because I'm going to be honest, I don't think they know who I am. and everybody, they seem to have no respect for me at all. And everybody says, does it make you want to be a mum? The fact that you now, you know, oh my God, does it make... And I'm like, I'm not their mum because they are adult guinea pigs. They know who they are.
You adopted them later on.
Yeah, you know, they're older than me. They know, you know, what their belief systems are. To them, I'm not their mother. I am their landlord. That is the relationship I've got with these guinea pigs.
I'm loving the idea that guinea pigs have belief systems.
You're their landlord? You're not just their cleaner?
I mean, to them, I think I'm probably Kathy Bates, if anything. I think it's misery for them. I'm just this big, long-legged ginger dinosaur that's like, eat the courgette! And they don't seem to appreciate the seesaw I made them or the artwork I put in their cage.
You put artwork in the cage?
Of course I did.
Of course you did.
And there's a whole bit in the show because I go on the guinea pig forum, which is the mum's net for the guinea pig owners.
And love it
is, once you get into that world, you cannot get out.
Is this a real thing?
Yes, and there is a man on it who...
I thought you'd made it up for the purpose of the show.
No.
The guinea pig forum.
So there is a gentleman on it called Elton Liberace who writes about his guinea pigs on it. He may be a real person. He may be me. Nobody knows. But I end up performing like it's a serious, like, Chekhov play. The interactions between everyone on the guinea pig forum and the arguments people have about whether it's dust or hay or fleece you put in your cage. And there was some phenomenal... Oh, the things that happened during in March when people were like, I'm really panicked about Brexit. What if we can't get any vegetables for our guinea pigs? How are they going to live?
Because that is a major concern that, for me as well.
Main problem.
Sleep. I'm really worried about this.
We do live in England, like a major farming area. I think guinea pigs are going to be fine for now. We're not going to just lose all the parsley after October the 31st. But anyway, so there's lots of silly things on
the
show.
Well, we're probably going back to Dig for Victory, which was a campaign in the war where everyone was encouraged to dig up their rose beds and plant turnips, which is a wonderful idea.
Yeah.
It's not a bad idea now, actually, is it? And I suppose with the allotment movement in the UK, it's happening anyway.
Yeah.
It's really good. Do the guinea pigs appear on stage with you?
I mean... I would love that, but guinea pigs, I'm not sure if you've ever met them, a guinea pig, but they're a very useless mop and an inefficient duster, and they are always within, like, one breath of death. Loud noises will affect a guinea pig. If you're wearing the wrong outfit, it'll affect a guinea pig. If I put them on stage with all the big lights and the loud Elton John music I've got playing, they would die of shock.
That would be a bit uncomfortable.
And I think it would just be a bit intense.
Of course, you'd have all the animal rights people lobbying outside the venue, saying, and don't see this show, it's got live guinea pigs in it.
And I look, I'm so in Medusa... No, I won't mention it. But in Medusa, because I'm performing as a Gorgon, I ate guinea pigs, not real guinea pigs, but we made grapefruits and covered them in fake fur. So I'm performing as a giant gorgon on stage, just eating these guinea pigs, which I then thought was quite funny because...
Sounds like a scene from...
I'm also a very strict vegetarian vegan lady. So animal welfare is of critical importance to me.
Can you imagine? Sounds like a scene from, of course, your most famous outing in the...
Yeah,
in
straight out of Game of Thrones.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And we'll talk about that when we come back. But we're going to get to a break now. I need a little bit of a rest, actually. And I'm just thinking about eating guinea pigs. There can't be a lot of meat on them, can there?
You know what? I wouldn't know. Because mine are long-haired, so I have to... I comb them and I... Yeah, anyway.
Well, we're going to go to a break now. When we come, we're going to be talking Game of Thrones. How exciting is that? We'll see you after these ads. Hello, welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. My talent-filled sofa this week. My final guest is Brannick O'Connor. And
hello.
I'm going to confess, I've never seen more than about 5 minutes of Game of Thrones, but you are one of the cast from Game of Thrones, and you had the most extraordinary part, because it's not in the book, is it?
No, I was very lucky. I auditioned for a one-episode appearance when I was 13. Character 295, boy in Hamlet. I was like, all right, sure.
Do it.
Five lines, was like, okay. Went for the audition, got a phone call, they really liked me, they wanted me to come in and do it. Shot my scene. Got another phone call. Do you want to come into Belfast next week and do more? I was like, okay. And then 3 years later, I was still there. And I'd killed off one of the main characters and
Getting hanged. You turned out to be a baddie.
Yeah, I didn't expect that. I didn't see that coming. It was a sweet, innocent boy at the beginning, Ollie. And everyone says he's a baddie. I don't think he's a baddie. He did it because his family got murdered and eaten in front of him. That would turn anyone a little bit wonky.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a joy of a show to work on. Everyone on it wanted to be there, and that's such a gift in TV.
Yeah. Where did you actually get to film?
I got what most people would assume is the bum end of the deal, but I really loved my time. I was in Belfast for 3 years, and they shoot in Croatia and Malta and Spain, and everyone was going, oh, when are you going there? Belfast is beautiful. Belfast is stunning.
But
it's one of my favourite
cities. But you didn't get to do the goes. It's just off Malta, isn't it?
Yeah, I didn't do any of the fancy. I did 1 week in Iceland for my first week,
right?
And then 3 years after that in Belfast, which was great. Got loads of lovely friends out there now. I love Ireland. Yeah.
I mean, when you're working on a series that runs for so long, you're away from home a huge amount of time. I mean, how do you manage a normal life when you have to be on set in a foreign country for that length of time?
Well, it's hard. It's hard to balance the two, like school, social life and work.
Of course, because you were still a schoolboy.
I was revising for my GCSEs while I was shooting those scenes. Oh. Yeah, it's intense.
Wow. Did you have to, like, get hanged and then go and do your maths GCSE? The
night that the stabbing of Jon Snow aired in America, I woke up and had to go and do my maths GCSE.
Yeah.
Immediately. And it was fun getting in the right headspace for one of the most important exams of your life, as you're told. while I'm getting tweet hate from America.
I mean, did you get a lot of
hate? Oh, yeah. I'm, like, bombarded with it. I still get it now.
It's extraordinary because, you know, I mean, OK, you end up killing one of the heroes for the right reasons, as you say. But then people tend to believe that it's the real world.
Yeah,
that was your own decision.
Yeah, I chose it. It definitely wasn't written down on a piece of paper and I was paid to say it. it's weird, but I just take it as a credit to everyone that's on that show, as we've made people believe it's real. We've made people believe in dragons again. It's a nice thing to know.
They are real.
Sure.
But it's not the only thing you've done. You're also in one of my favourite TV comedies, Derry Girls.
Yes.
Which I think is an absolute joy, because it takes me back to a period in time when I was quite young, and just looking at the fashion's a joy in itself. Yeah. That also the political upheaval in Northern Ireland. Again, Belfast again.
Yeah, I was out in Belfast again. It was
running theme.
Majorly the same crew. It was lovely. I walked onto it. It's always weird going onto a set. It's like the first day of school, and as an actor, you go onto so many different sets and go through the first day of school so many times, but the fear never changes. Yeah. You're always like, Christ. And I walked on, and I had the same second assistant director. I was like, okay, it was the same crew. It was just like, it felt like home.
Lovely.
Not being there for 3 years and going back into, just felt natural. And that show's amazing. All the girls are great, and Dylan's amazing, yeah.
Now, you're doing something really important at the moment, and you're here to talk a little bit about this, because, you know, everyone wants just to know Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
But you're launching a scholarship in your name.
I am indeed. I used to go to WMCS in Worthing, and I trained there, and when I was about 11, I read in the Primary Times that there was a scholarship being offered to the Theatre Workshop in Brighton. It was one of these slightly more expensive schools that I couldn't afford in the bracket that we are. And I was like, I'd like to audition for it. My mum said, yeah, you can go for it. It was the Christopher Biggins Scholarship, because he'd just become a patron. And my mum sent me up because she thought, and she's told me this recently, she thought it would be a good idea for me to accept failure from a young age. So she sent me to go and learn about failure. And I got it. So take that.
Bless her. Is your mum going to be watching this?
She will
love you, really.
yes, and then I left last year. I was there for 7 years, received some of the best training I've ever received, worked with some incredible professionals, did some great shows. I did The Fringe last year.
Yeah.
And it's been an absolute joy. And now that I'm working and I'm earning, I think the only decent thing to do is put back into it. So I'm offering a scholarship, the same scholarship that I got when I was 11, and we're auditioning this weekend.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
So is there still time for people? This is going to be, as we go out now, it's sort of 9:45 on Wednesday evening.
Absolutely.
Is there still time to apply?
Yeah, the auditions are on Sunday. If you want to apply, go onto Instagram, find a theatre workshop and send them a DM and they'll send you all the details. I believe it's a monologue to bring along. I'll be there. I'll be watching you all.
Wearing
judging.
This.
Oh, wearing this, surely. Got to so brighten up the room. Yeah, I'll be there. A monologue. If you sing, bring a song. If you play an instrument, bring it along. I play. I'm always interested to see young people play music. And the talent that's already at Theatre Workshop now is incredible. I went back to the Oscarettes that was at the Hilton the other month, and it's insane. The new generation that's coming through is great. So, yeah, it feels nice to be giving it back.
Now, you revealed to me earlier that you've actually performed here in the latest music bar.
I have. Yeah, that was with the Theatre Workshop event, actually. I did. I played two songs downstairs. a long time ago. I didn't realise until I got back in here. I went, oh, yeah, I remember this place. Yeah, yeah, it's nice.
So you're not really a baddie at all, are
you? I'm not. In real life, I'm quite sweet, I've been told. But I can do a good mean face, so people hire me to do that.
Oh, let's see the mean face.
Can we see that?
Oh, OK.
Focus. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's dark.
See, that's the reaction I usually get when I try it in real life. The other people are being paid to pretend to be fearful as well.
I love the fact you're like, the younger generation are coming through and they're brilliant. Mm. And then, what year were you born?
Yeah, 2000.
Oh, no.
You baby.
I'm a baby boy, but these are babies like at Theatre Workshop. They go from 6 to 18.
Yeah, and that's also auditioning at that time. I remember doing auditions when I was little to do like National Youth Theatre.
Yeah, yeah.
And the amount of pressure people
ridiculous.
Put on you. And actually, like you said, it's really good to just turn up and go, oh, that didn't work. I failed.
Yeah.
Cool. It's okay. Just
exactly.
Auditioning is the most important thing, just to practice doing it.
What's your next role?
My next thing, I've just finished on the TV adaptation of Anthony Horowitz's Alex Rider books. About the teenage spy. I play the nerdy best friend, of
course.
Fantastic. So I've just finished that on last Saturday, which was a lot of fun. We've been shooting that for about 8 months, so it feels good to be out of that and get some headspace. But I'm about to go over to New York and do a musical off-Broadway of the John Carney film Sing Street.
Amazing.
So, yeah, that would be a lot of fun.
Because, of course, you sing as well.
I do. I had a very traumatic thing like you did with your back. My voice is majorly messed up from damage I did 7 years ago.
Did you get the modules? Whatever?
No, I didn't. It's stranger than that. I did the Oliver tour when I was 12.
Oh, yes.
And I burst a blood vessel on my left vocal cord. Yeah. And I didn't know about any of that until I started training for Sing Street. Oh. And they went, oh, yeah, this is what's happened. So for 4 days, I had to be on vocal steroids and complete vocal rest. Yes. And it's that fear of going, will this get better? I completely get what you were saying earlier.
I still remember when I was doing Swan at Edinburgh Fringe 2017 and it just got nominated for the Comedy Award and my voice completely packed up. And it was a one woman in French, really high spectacle, and I did loads of singing. Mm-hmm. And I just had like pure honey,
Manuka
pure
honey,
Beechams. And I was in between scenes just like gallivanting it back,
dear.
The term of phrase. So I could be like, punch up. Yeah. And since then, my voice has not been the same
exactly.
at all.
Exactly. So that was me for 7 years. I'm only now getting a head voice back. I sort of went through my voice breaking and never got a head voice back.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I guess that's just not what I've got. But I realised I've just been singing wrong for 7 years. So I've got a great team working with me now, yeah.
Brilliant. Well, listen, thank you all so much for coming again. The Coast is Queer starts on the 12th September at the Spire in Brighton. You'll be on the telly for probably the rest
You'll
of my
see
life
me around.
And beyond. And you're at Comedia on...
The 9th of October, which is a Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Everybody should come.
Guinea pig heaven. Thank you all so much for coming. It's been fantastic. I feel so untalented sat at this end of my sofa. It's really unbalanced, isn't it? I also feel like, for the first time, I'm the dullest person on the show. Thanks for that. I'm normally the brightest person on the sofa, but there
Apologies.
You go. Can't win everything. Thanks for watching this week. And we'll be back next week with yet more guests. We'll see you then. Good night. Look out. Look out.